I'm hopeless on State of Britain questions. I think they're the most boring books to be written, called The State of Britain and all the rest of it. What would I say, though? I mean, I'd say that in many ways we've made a lot of progress, that when I look back, you know, it is amazing that when I went to the press gallery of the House of Commons in 1958, I was about 23 years old, one quarter of the Conservative Party, the governing party, came from the same school. One quarter of Conservative MPs were Old Etonians. We went on to have three prime ministers on the trot who came from the same school. We went on to have Eden, Macmillan, Douglas Hume. In succession, three Old Etonians. Now, I'm not against Mr. Cameron being an Old Etonian. Good luck to him. But I don't think we'll ever see David Cameron succeeded by two other schoolfellows again. So in some ways, we've made progress. We also made progress, I think, in terms of representation of minorities. Not good enough yet in the House of Commons, not good enough for women, certainly not good enough for ethnic minorities, but we've made progress, and things are better off than they were. Where have we slipped back? I think we've slipped back in creating a Brahmin caste who are quite different from the rest of us. And this Brahmin caste are the people who become politicians, who go into politics. They're picked off, like, say, the Dalai Lama or something, at a very tender age, go into the Conservative Research Department, go into the Trade Union Research Department, they're about 21, and they've never done anything else in their lives. Never, ever. Now, you've already got a civil service that consists of a Brahmin caste. That's how they're recruited. They're sort of recruited from the moment they leave the university, and they spend the next 40 years in Whitehall. Do you want to duplicate that with those who are meant to be the people in the front office? I can't see the point of it. It seems to me that it was better, though some people think it was very old-fashioned, that when I first became a journalist, if you went to the House of Commons, you were enormously saw all these brigadiers on the back benches, you saw all these sort of rear admirals, you saw businessmen even, you saw people who were Sheffield master cutler and this kind of thing. None of that exists today. There is no one in politics really who's come up the hard way. There is that guy who's in the cabinet, Johnson, I think he's been a postman, and became General Secretary of the Post Office Workers' Union. But that's very unusual. When I first went into the press gallery, you look down, there were quite a lot of ex-union leaders on the floor of the House of Commons. Ernie Bevin blazed the way, but after that there were Alf Robins, people like that. None of that exists anymore. Instead of which, we have a caste, a cadre, that has been sort of trained from the word go, who have never known any other life but the life of being in politics, who have no experience of the world outside, who I think I think this is why the political class is rapidly growing apart from the general public, because it is so secluded. And that certainly is where one place where at least I think things have got worse rather than better. And it happened, I think, largely by accident. We've had one or two throwbacks along the way. Somebody like Michael Heseltine belongs to the old dispensation, who make your money and become a businessman, then go into politics. People don't do that anymore. Probably he's the last one we shall see of that kind of person. They may take a job in PR, like David Cameron, with some television company or something. Basically, they've done nothing except what they know about. They become, and I think this may be one of the troubles, may go back to these special advisors that were invented. Not really till about the beginning of the 1970s, I think, or thereabouts, that you got this sort of recruited young men, bright young men, who went to work for Secretaries of State here and there, and they immediately got bitten by the bugs. They wanted to become Secretaries of State themselves, therefore they became, first of all, MPs. It may have gone back to that, because we didn't have special advisors. I think Wilson may have had a special advisor or two as Prime Minister, but most cabinet ministers just rubbed along with their own civil servants. We've suddenly got this breed created of these people who are brought in, and once they're inside, they never leave the tent afterwards. So they've had probably something to do with the development of this strange political caste that we've seen in this country, which we never used to have, and is now, I think, stronger than it's ever been. So what else would I say about the state of the nation? Not much. I mean, I think that probably, as far as the media are concerned, we've probably had the best years. I think newspapers are almost bound to die. And I think that we've certainly had the best years as far as television is concerned. That the breakup even of the whole regional structure of ITV, I think the history will say, was a great mistake. How long the license fee can keep going with the BBC, God knows, but I wouldn't think it would be forever. So I think we, in media terms, we are on the cusp of big, big changes. Other things? Decline, I suppose, if people would say, the decline of morality, I'm not sure about that. Certainly decline of church going, that's something that has changed in my lifetime quite sort of considerably. Otherwise, I don't think I've got any great message for the nation. I'm against apocalyptic utterances on the whole. Maybe I've been too apocalyptic about this and that over the state of the nation, but I think, you know, you always have to remember that life goes on. Life does not sort of change in dramatic sequences. When people say that the world changed 9/11, balls, it didn't. So I think that melodramatic statements of that kind don't do any good, and on the whole, it's amazing how little things change. That may be depressing for those with a sort of radical turn of mind, but it is, I think, true that there aren't that many sort of Soviet revolutions and stuff that take place, and I suspect that we're wrong in thinking that we are living in our own generation, see the end of history. Nonsense titles of that kind. It's not how life works.